Okay, so in the last lecture, we started to discuss about the manufacturing of viscose rayon. Viscose rayon, how it is manufactured, there are various steps involved that we have discussed, like steeping, shredding, aging, xanthation, filtration, blending, ripening, spinning, and then some after treatments, how to do the after treatment that we have seen. Then we stopped the lecture. So I hope every one of you have understood the manufacturing of viscose rayon. In the manufacturing of viscose rayon, other processes like steeping, shredding may be little easy to understand. Steeping, shredding, aging, but the important process like xanthation is very important. Ripening process is very important. How it is done, and especially the spinning bath, which we discussed yesterday, what are the ingredients present and what is the role of each ingredient that we have seen, and how the sulfuric acid pH, it is helping regenerating the cellulose, and how the zinc sulfate is playing a role in making the structural regulation done, and how the sodium sulfate works as a salting out reagent. Okay, so these three things should be understood properly. So the role of zinc is very important for the orientation of the viscose polymer chains so that you will get the mechanical properties. So till here we discussed in the previous lecture. So Pawar Pandurang, did you understand that what is salting out?
Yes, sir.
Did you, Can you tell me how the salting out, what is the use of the salting out agent, how with the use of salt, how you remove the salt or how you separate, how it happens? Can you tell?
नहीं सर, मुझे कुछ मेरा
हाँ, समझ में नहीं आया? पवार, डिड यू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज द साल्टिंग आउट रिएजेंट? नॉट अंडरस्टूड? See, there are two things. One is the
ना
salting in. Okay, now I will explain you. There are two things. One is the salting in, and another is the salting out. What is the difference between them? Salting in means, for example, if you are to any kind of a solution, whether it is a protein solution or if you take a system like a cellulose, if you are adding a salt, okay, like any kind of a salt, if you are using like sodium chloride or sodium sulfate, if you are using any kind of a salt in the you are adding, in that case let us assume that you are adding a sodium chloride. Okay, the ionic strength of the sodium chloride is less. Okay, let us say that ionic strength is less for the sodium chloride. So with the increase in the concentration of the sodium chloride, what will happen? The solubility of the protein solution will increase. Okay, with the less ionic strength solution, the solubility of the protein solution will increase. Here in our case, we are not using a protein solution, we are using a cellulose solution. So here, if you add with a less concentration, with a less ionic strength of the salt solution, the solubility of the cellulose will increase. Okay, that is this salting in, where you have added the salt to improve the solubility. Okay, because here we have actually, what did we do? We do the steeping, shredding, and we made a cellulose fluid. Okay, we made the cellulose fluid. We dissolved it. We xanthated it. We substituted the group of the cellulose with the sulfur to dissolve it. Okay, but in the salting in solution, our primary motive is to dissolve the protein or dissolve the cellulose. But whereas in the salting out, we need to separate the protein or separate the cellulose from the salt. Okay, in salting out, what we do is we use a higher ionic strength of the salt. Okay, the sodium sulfate which you are adding, this has a higher ionic strength. You can see the concentration that is used when compared with the other reagents. Regenerating agent, you are using only 8 to 10%, and compound forming agent like zinc sulfate, you are using only 1 to 2%, but salting out agent, you are using 16 to 24%, very high, double the amount of regenerating agent. So why you are adding more amount of the sodium sulfate? So what happens If you add more amount of a salt which has a higher ionic strength, that will actually react more with the water or more with the solvent. Okay. Instead of it acting with the protein or cellulose. So that time what will happen if you add more quantity of a higher ionic strength salt inside the solution, what will happen is the salt whichever is already present, that will also join with this salt which you have added to form some agglomeration. Okay, that will get separated. Salt will get separated from the cellulose. Okay, cellulose will be separate and salt will be separate. Why it happens? Because of the higher ionic strength of the salt that you have added, higher concentration and higher ionic strength of the salt that you have added, that will separate out both the cellulose as well as the salt. So salt will go separately and cellulose will go separately, because finally you are interested only in the fiber which is without salt, without sulfur, without any kind of a thing, only the viscose rayon you want. Okay, even you don't want the zinc after you manufacture it. Okay, so it is a separation process where you separate out the salt from the cellulose. Okay, but this will not happen if you are using only a low concentration of a salt which has a less ionic strength. If you are using a less ionic strength salt, what will happen? Less ionic strength will actually promote the solubility. Okay, it will make the cellulose to soluble in water or soluble in the alkali. Okay, already you have made it soluble by xanthation. So if you add a less concentration of a less ionic strength salt, that will only promote the solubility. Okay, but for a higher ionic strength solution, what will happen is there is a more chance of reaction with the water or the solvent rather than with the cellulose. Okay, so that is the reason why this salting out reagent is used. It is used for separation. Okay, it is used to separate out the salt and the cellulose, separate it out both. Okay, so did you understand, Pandurang? Pandurang? Huh? Your voice is not clear. So you do one thing. If you are not understood, you then message me separately. I will clear your doubt for more if you want to know. So we will now go further in the today's lecture. So we have discussed about the manufacture in detail in the previous lecture. So here in today's lecture, we will move on to discuss about the properties. So what are the physical properties first we will see, then we will see the chemical property and the other applications. So what are the physical properties? First important property from the viscose rayon is the tenacity. Okay, so you see the tenacity of the viscose rayon, it is actually weaker than the cotton, because both are cellulosic fiber. One is a regenerated, viscose is a regenerated fiber, but both contain the cellulose only. But the difference is this fiber, viscose rayon, it is highly amorphous and less crystalline. Okay, because of the less crystalline nature, what happens? There is some very shorter and poorly aligned hydrogen bonds. So only very less formation of hydrogen bonds is possible in the viscose rayon. Okay, so that it is highly amorphous in the sense more than 60% of the polymer system is amorphous. So that what will happen when the viscose rayon is immersed in water, the water will penetrate inside the polymer system and it will break the small number of hydrogen bond that is already present and it will make the fiber wet. Okay, so it has a poor tenacity. Okay, it has a poor tenacity. You, instead of say poor, you can say fair tenacity. When you compare it with cotton, it has a fair tenacity only. Okay, so that is the reason you need to know why the tenacity of the viscose rayon is less. Next is the elastic and plastic nature. As I have told you, this is an amorphous type of a fiber, so it is a little limp, little thin type of a handle you will get when you feel it in your hand. And here, like a cotton, where by the nature itself, there is a proper type of a polymer chain alignment and orientation is possible in the cotton. That kind of a satisfactory alignment and the formation of hydrogen bonds, it is not possible with this kind of a polymer system. Okay, so it is a little rigid polymer system and it gives some crispy handle. If you feel the viscose fabric, you may understand it gives some crispy handle. So what will happen if you just put this viscose rayon fiber under the strain, like any kind of a tensile strength type of an instrument if you use, what will happen? Because of its amorphous nature and very few hydrogen bonds, that will allow the polymer to slide past each other. Okay, so that what will happen if you remove that strain, again it will not go back, the polymers will not go back to the same position. Okay, the polymer chains will not again return back. So there will be some disarrangement in the system. Okay, so already I have told you this has a less number of hydrogen bonds and polymer chain length is also less and less crystallinity. So these things make the viscose rayon, when you do any kind of apply some strain, the fiber will get distorted, it will get stretched and wrinkled or creased also. If you take a viscose fabric and just crumple with your hand, it will get creased easily and it will not easily recover from the crease until and unless you do some ironing or anything like that. Okay, so that is the thing. Next, chemical properties. As I told you, it is a highly amorphous fiber, 60 to 65% amorphous. So it is a very polar kind of a polymer. Okay, polar in the sense it will be highly water absorbing. Okay, so these fibers are used as a super absorbent fibers. I think you may have heard this word called SCIF, super absorbent fibers, which will have a high absorption. Okay, wherever end users that require the high absorption, there this fibers can be used because it is highly hygroscopic. Okay, because the polymer system is 60 to 65% amorphous and 30 to 35% crystalline. One third is crystalline and two third is amorphous. That is the difference. Okay. Thermal properties. What is the thermal property of this viscose rayon? So here, now you yourself can tell this has a highly amorphous kind of a polymer system. So when you apply some heat over this surface, what will happen? Because of the lesser crystallinity and higher amorphous system, this fiber has a poor heat conductivity than the cotton. If you apply some more heat, then what will happen? The temperature that you apply for the cotton, if you apply the same for the viscose rayon, it cannot withstand. Okay, so what will happen is this thermal conductivity is poor. This fiber will actually thermally easily degrade with a less temperature. So that is the understanding. Because it is a man-made and regenerated fiber, and this polymer system, if you see, it is a less crystalline, and though the polymer system is rigid, it is a less crystalline, only one third crystalline and two third amorphous. So it has a lower heat resistance and poorer heat conductivity. Okay, it cannot withstand higher temperature. Okay. Next is the chemical property. So whatever properties that you have studied for cotton, the same property is there for the viscose rayon also. It is actually easily affected by acid, alkali, bleaching agent, sunlight and weather when compared with cotton. Acid resistance is highly poor. If you expose it to any acids like sulfuric acid, what will happen? The strength will go away. Okay, because it is a weak fiber. Okay, but with alkali, comparatively, when you compare with acid, alkali is much better when you expose the viscose rayon fabric with the alkali. Okay, so that is the difference. And another is, when you do the dyeing or printing for the viscose fabric, on the viscose fabric, this when you do the dyeing or printing, the fabric will be highly brighter. Why it is brighter? Because it is two-third amorphous. Whatever dye or color that is absorbed by the fiber, that will completely reflect back when any kind of a light is exposed over that fabric, that whatever color that is absorbed, that will be reflected back. So it will be looking brighter in color. Okay, that is why certain dress materials which are made up of viscose rayon, when it is dyed with some colors, it will look very brighter. Okay. So even when you have added some titanium dioxide or anything to reduce the luster, still the luster is high for the viscose rayon. Application, yes, it has a very good application. You can make some embroidery thread, novelty yarns, apparel. You can use it in saris, jackets, sportswear, sports shirts, work cloths. This can be made even in the domestic textiles. You can use it in the curtains, sheets, draperies. In industrial textiles, you can use it as a reinforcement of mechanical rubber goods. You can take this viscose rayon and you can try to join with the rubber to improve. You can make a composite, like a viscose rayon rubber type of a composite. You can make some braided cards, you can make some tapes out of it. And importantly, one more application is that I told you, super absorbent polymers. Wherever application you require higher moisture uptake you want, there you can use this viscose rayon fibers. Okay, and that's all about the viscose rayon, one of the very important fiber to be studied. So this is about the manufacturing properties and application of viscose rayon. Then further discussion on viscose rayon will be on the derivatives that we will see. So do you understand the lecture of the viscose rayon? If you have understood, tell me. If you have any doubts, otherwise we will proceed further or stop it, whatever. You can tell me.
Yes, sir. Understood.
Understood. Have you understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Fine then. We will move further on the topic called derivatives of viscose rayon. We will stop the viscose rayon and we will move on to derivatives. We will see one derivative today. So we will see other derivatives later. Okay, could you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, fine. Okay, so we will see the derivatives of the viscose rayon. So in the viscose rayon, there are some many derivatives are there, but from our discussion, we will be restricting to two important derivatives that are commercially used. One is the polynosic rayon and another is the tensile polynosic rayon and lyocell rayon. These both the rayons we will discuss. There are many other rayons also, like cupromonium rayon, like that, but we are not going to see that because it's not commercially used. You can read about it. So we will first see today the polynosic rayon in brief, one of the important rayon used. So this polynosic, the word, you can understand that this polynosic means it's a fibril. This contains a lot of small fibril present in the structure. Okay, so here this polynosic rayon is otherwise called as modal. Okay, you can see the word called modal. So this modal, why this name came? Because of the modulus. This fiber has a high modulus and high tenacity when compared with the normal viscose rayon. That is why this is named as modal fiber. Okay, so this is also a regenerated cellulose, this is also a viscose rayon, but difference is this has a high tenacity and high wet modulus. Okay, you know well that I have explained you already in the previous discussion that viscose rayon has a poor wet strength because of the few amount of hydrogen bonds and water penetrating the hydrogen structure and destroying the hydrogen bonds. So that has a poor wet strength, but when you compare it with the normal viscose rayon, this polynosic has a high tenacity and high wet modulus. Then how do you manufacture this? We are not going to extensively discuss about how this fiber is manufactured, but we will only see the difference between the normal viscose rayon manufacturing process and polynosic rayon manufacturing process. Here in the polynosic rayon, what we do is we just use a weak spinning bath. I hope you remember in the viscose rayon how much amount of sulfuric acid we used, higher concentration of sulfuric acid we used. But here we are not going to use a higher concentration, rather we are going to use a lower concentration. Okay, and what we do is we will add sodium sulfate also that we have used as a salting out reagent in the previously for the viscose rayon, but we are going to omit the zinc sulfate. That is the difference from the main viscose rayon process and this viscose rayon process. The difference in the spinning bath is this is the difference. So what is the reason for that? The reason is we do not allow the xanthate to decompose very fast. We do not allow the xanthate to remove it. We want to maintain the xanthate in the xanthation level itself, where the cellulose group is substituted with some sulfur groups. We are going to do some stretch before you regenerate that fiber. What we do is in the xanthated cellulose will be stretched. Okay, so that during the stretching, what you will get, you will align the fiber in the fiber axis direction. Okay, that will make the improvement in the orientation. So you will get a structure that will be high orientation and high modulus when compared with the viscose rayon. Okay, and one more difference, what you do is when you do the aging process, aging means something storing it for some more time, like 1 or 3 days. Okay, when you do the aging, what did you do in the viscose rayon? Whatever alkali cellulose is there, that you stored it so that only the oxygen will react with that, and it will reduce the degree of polymerization. It is a depolymerization step. We did it during the viscose rayon. We reduced it. But here what we do is we eliminate that stage. We do not do the aging. After steeping and shredding, we directly go for the xanthation. Okay, and what other steps we remove? We remove the ripening also. Ripening is also like a storing only. We keep it till the fiber gets coagulated, cellulose gets coagulated and ready for spinning. We eliminate that step also. And one more difference what we do is we do not dissolve it in the alkali. We dissolve it in the water. Okay. So whatever xanthate that is formed, that is dissolved in the water. This is the difference. One is the you use a weak spinning bath, you add sodium sulfate, and you omit the zinc sulfate. You allow the xanthate to decompose slowly so that you can give some stretch to it to improve the orientation and the mechanical properties. And then you eliminate the aging and ripening step. This thing you should know. We do not need to see again. Discuss about how this is manufactured in detail. Only this elimination and omissions and inclusions, if you know, that is sufficient for that. Okay, so if you observe this recipe for the viscose solution, you can see you have the cellulose of 6%, sodium hydroxide of 4.4%. It has some gamma value to maintain the degree of polymerization. You can see the degree of polymerization is around 500 to 600 and viscosity is 500. So here, the important thing is the degree of polymerization. If you compare it with the viscose rayon, in the viscose rayon, the degree of polymerization is just 200 or 250, very less. Okay, but here, because of some modification in the process, we have eliminated that aging step. Because of that, we are getting a higher degree of polymerization. So higher degree of polymerization, obviously, you are going to get some good improvement in the mechanical properties. And in spinning bath, if you observe, we are using a less concentration of sulfuric acid and we are using the same concentration of sodium sulfate, but we have not added the zinc. That is the difference. Okay, and temperature, time and spinning speed is the same. But what you are doing is you give a high stretch. Okay, you can see around 150 to 300% type of a stretch you are importing before you regenerate that fiber. Okay. So that is the difference. So the spinning speed of around say 100 meters per minute you get, and you make the polynosic fiber. Okay. So this is the difference of how the polynosic is different from the normal viscose rayon. So we will just see the properties in brief, and then we'll stop here with the today's lecture. So if you see the properties, make a comparison against the normal viscose rayon. This normal viscose rayon, you see, it is less crystalline and highly amorphous, but whereas polynosic is highly crystalline. Not highly crystalline in the sense like 80% or 90%, relatively 10 percentage points higher than the viscose rayon, so that it will be relatively higher crystalline when compared with the normal viscose rayon. Okay, in the normal viscose rayon, what will happen if you add the water? Water will penetrate inside the polymer system, it will break some hydrogen bonds, and that will lead to less strength. But here, it permits only fewer water molecules inside the polymer system. Okay, because of the allowing the fewer water molecules, your viscose rayon, this polynosic rayon, is not that much affected by the, as you compared with the viscose rayon. Okay, so this has a better strength, better tenacity. Okay, and it has some feeling wise, you can see somewhat less limp than viscose. So normally, if you feel the viscose rayon, you will feel something like a plastic feeling. That kind of a feeling you will not get it from the polynosic. Very less limp will be there, you can observe from that. And since you have done some stretching, as I discussed with you, how much strength your stretch you are giving. So because you are making the proper alignment, okay, you have made the proper alignment, so obviously you will get the good mechanical properties. Okay, and one more important thing is that this is less absorbent than viscose. It is not just like a normal viscose rayon where around 65% amorphous region is there, where absorbency will be very perfect, very excellent. Here the absorbance will be relatively, it will be less when you compare with the viscose rayon. Okay, so this is the difference between the viscose rayon and the polynosic rayon. Polynosic rayon is the derivative of the viscose rayon. Okay, so like that we will see one more important viscose rayon in the next lecture. So if you have any doubt, you can ask. Otherwise, we will stop here for today.